I'm very fortunate to come back 2 years running. I was here last year dressed as a Jedi, and I had a Stormtrooper Princess Leia, and actually it was a much easier sell actually doing this type of talk. This year they've invited me back to talk about social media. Social media is the thing we need to understand. When you're exporting, you know, you have a global market where you don't have to physically be there to actually be able to be competitive. So I'm going to give you some ideas. I'm going to talk you through a process, give you some settings as to why the world has changed, why you need to be involved in it. If you go back the last kind of 150 years, you look at the technology revolution, it's been quite phenomenal. You look at things like cat's eyes, they revolutionized road safety, such a simple invention. But probably the biggest single thing that's transformed our lives is this thing, is the World Wide Web, is the internet. I mean, how many of you got the user guide? Did you get the user guide? None of you? Did you get the user guide? Yeah, they got it at the back, so they're the only ones. But the problem is that we've been given this thing for free. And like anything, you know, no user guide, we all learn bad habits because we don't understand the way we use things. And it's easy for us to bury our heads. And social media amongst anyone over the age of 25 is a bad word, right? And particularly when you get into education, don't even mention social media. You know, because Snapchat, surely that's all about kids sharing naked pictures with each other. But that's what we all did. We just had Polaroids in the time. You know, the world hasn't changed. The way that kids evolve and they adolesce has not changed. They have a mechanism and a way in which they can communicate. And businesses are really, really slow at adopting this. It's because we don't understand it. So I'm going to take you on a little bit of a journey to kind of try and break this understanding. And if we look at the way that technology is evolving, this is Moore's Law. Moore's Law dictates that technology will double in power and half in size every 18 months. Yeah? And the problem with this is that with this exponential rise, and you look around this great hall here, everyone's throwing you MR, VR, AR, touchscreen this, touchscreen that. You can build a robot. You can send someone to Mars. This is all brilliant. But the problem with these things, well, I'm like the Antichrist when it comes to Bett, because I come here and going, technology is bad. Yeah? Stop buying technology. We've got to stop buying it, because actually the first thing that's going to fail is us, is humans, is people, because we buy these kind of tools and these gimmicks and we hope that it's going to fix our problems. But technology in itself is an addict, you know, makes us addictive to these kind of ways in which to use it. Look at the way that we use our devices. And so with this kind of this huge acceleration in technology, we find it very hard to keep up as people. Yeah, we just make do. And it's the same thing, just like the internet, no user go, no nothing. But we need to take time to understand social media. You know, when we look at technology, the irony of it all, you know, we want our kids to be more active. We want them to get outside. And, you know, teachers aren't using technology necessarily in the best way, because this is the way we're all turning out. More sedentary lives, more time in front of a computer, in our screens, and all these things. And in these kind of this great hall, I mean, it's like four football pitches long. You know, there's a lot of future tech here, and it's exciting. And you're right to be excited. I'm excited by technology, with Alexa, with voice, with AI, where that's going. But we've got to worry about the social element of it all. And then how do we use it? And social media is really just a conversation. We just kind of get labeled with different platforms and channels as if it's bad and we don't really get it and how am I going to be effective? And the problem with social media is it's free. Yeah? And the problem with free is that anybody thinks they can do it. You know, we get on there, but the difference between a good tweet and a bad tweet is about 500,000 people. You've got to be effective. And we're struggling with content at the moment. And so you kind of look at social media. I'm going to show you a little video here. This is by Eric Quallman. And if you want to go and have a look at it, it's a video called Socialnomics. And it'll just give you a kind of set the scene when it comes to this is what's going on in social right now.
We'll be right back.
some fascinating context, actually, to social. You know, when we think about the goldfish, the attention spans, I mean, we're all guilty of it. You know, in the way we kind of very much everything's bite-sized. And so for you to compete in a social digital world from your marketing when you're selling your brand, your product, your service, is very, very difficult. And the reason is this, is that we have a social landscape. You're not meant to understand this in terms of every single platform. New platforms emerge every single day. There's new platforms being emerged in the future learn space over here. They may not survive, but they are becoming niche products that people buy into. But the key thing you've got to take away from this is to understand there are three areas of social and when it comes to content. The first side is the kind of the listening, and there's a huge amount of listening going on. You know, you think about your smart home, your smart devices, everything, the smart city. It's the telemetric side of recording information. In the second segment, we've got the education side, the learning, the contribution, and we're all guilty of adding to this. We add learning resources, we put up blogs. You might share your own opinions on Facebook or YouTube. You might put your own videos up. We're adding to this. But the biggest problem we've got is that how do we consume it? Yeah, and there's a real phenomenon called content shock that I'll cover shortly. But what we've got to do, and actually if you want to create your next billion-dollar business, it's in curation, it's in adaption. It's how do you take all this noise, all this content that exists, and actually deliver it to the right person at the right time? Because that's going to be essential when you're trying to sell your marketing message. How do you target the right people? Because right now, you're actually trying to contribute and target them in a way that everybody as well is trying to attract their attention. How do you get their attention? It's very difficult. You know, think about Pinterest. It's a curation tool. Bloody good invention, but it's a curation tool. Netflix, it really is just a curation tool that I can access that type of information. So you've got to start to think then about your content strategy, and your content strategy is going to be crucial. And we hear a lot about inbound marketing and all this about stuff, but all you're doing is adding noise because nothing is effective, nothing strategic. We feel like we have to do a blog or we have to be on Twitter. What about Instagram? Oh, that's where the kids are. Let's be on there. And the young mums, let's be on Instagram. But we end up posting the same content to the same platforms without understanding the people and the groups in which they consume that content. There is a big difference between social media and social networking, and there's a distinction you need to understand because we kind of bundle it all up into the same thing. You know, and social media really is this. It's kind of digital communications where people and communities share content of like type. So whether YouTube, it's a very good example of a great social media platform. Yeah, I don't go on there to read a book. Yeah, I don't go there anything else apart from to look at video. Social networking, in contrast, is the sharing of social media. You know, and these are the kind of the big three social networks there, where we've got Facebook, we've got LinkedIn, and we've got Twitter. Because what I share in my professional profile in LinkedIn is not what I share in my private profile, which is Facebook. Very rarely do I share the same content. In my professional profile, I'm sharing content that's related to what I do professionally, whether it's social media, or it's school marketing, whether it's future school vision. I don't go putting that to my friends because they go, what on earth are you sharing that for? It's dull, it's boring. Who the hell do you think you are? You know, that's for the nights out. That's for the kids' parties. That's for sharing personal moments with my close network of friends. Twitter kind of sits in the middle and is a kind of a hybrid between my professional and my private life, but it's more my hobby life rather than my deep personal life, which kind of Facebook kind of consumes, as well as Instagram, Snapchat, etc. But all of these are around collaboration. It's about sharing, it's about connections. And we too often try and get too many connections too quickly. You know, when we all got on Facebook and you watch what our kids do on Snapchat, it's how many people they kind of, how many friends you've got, how many people follow you, how many streaks you've got. You all familiar with streaks? Yeah, all the youngsters, yeah, of course, I've got streaks, yeah? Snapchat, you need to learn about it, why? They're on streaks, why they do it. It builds up social equity. It becomes a popularity barometer for children, yeah? And so we've got to understand these platforms if you're going to market. And you can't be in all of them, yeah? The danger is you kind of go, well, we need to do a Snapchat story. We've got to say we're on Snapchat. We've got to start doing Instagram. Everything's got to have a value to it, a benefit, a purpose, yeah? Why are you doing it? Because it's your time you're doing it. This is known as the internet minute, yeah? 60 seconds on the internet, how much content is contributed by people and systems around the world. It's phenomenal. This amount of data is more than the average 17th century person consumed in a lifetime. This is 1 minute, yeah? So herein lies our problem, yeah? You've got all this content going everywhere. You've got the Internet of Things coming along where it's connecting more things together, more content, more platforms, more devices, more access points. Your job and your message is gonna be harder. You know, you're gonna be trying to talk to somebody who's connected to a smart fridge. How do you market to someone who's trying to, you know, replace their eggs, or I'm just trying to get the milk out the fridge and there it is? Because your marketeers and brands are gonna be wanting to buy into that space. Because it's a window of my time, yeah? And my time's becoming shorter and shorter, like yours are. You know, you think about your own behavior and your own habits when you go online. You steal a few minutes here. What's your behavior when you log onto social? Do you actively just kind of casually go down? We don't. We do this. Stop. This. Why? We're addicted to visual stimulants, yeah? The dopamine reaction. It comes, we get addicted. We want to do, we want visual, yeah? We want that stimulation. So we've got to think about the content you provide, because this is going to be your kind of your ecosystem. The content that you share, is it going to go here and is it going to go everywhere? Because your consumers are going to access it in any platform, whether it's learning resources, whether it's not, whether it's just marketing communications, more devices, more platforms, everything is connected. So our job's actually more difficult now. But the problem is we don't have a content strategy. And I call this content shock. And content shock is a phenomenon. It's an idea that the rate of production of content is completely overtaken the rate that we can consume it. And we already passed that years ago, yeah? And if we already passed it, and sort of the rate of consumption is doing this and the rate of production is doing this, we're at a dangerous place because there's a lot of noise out there. And the noise is because most of the content that's out there is unstructured. In other words, it's not easy to find the stuff. You know, how many of you go past the first page in Google when you search? We don't, do we? Yeah. Google's really good. It's a corporate search engine, yeah? It's very good for finding cheap hotels, cheap flights, the best of this, the best of that, yeah? For education and learning, well, 99% of school leavers do not know how to search, yeah? It's a fact, because we rely on a simple box because Google got it. Yahoo didn't, AOL didn't, because they put these big dashboards with stock tickers that no one had, but they, you know, we wanted to build these dashboards. They gave us one box. And so when you think about your marketing, you think about your social media, it's about people. You know, Google got it because they said, look, just put anything into this one little window and I'll give you anything you like. It'll always be the right answer. But we never go past the first 10, right? So how do I know it's right? So we're at this point where we need more structure. So when you're thinking about your content strategy, you've got to start to put more structure around it. And I'll show you some examples why. You think about, the behavior and which way we consume it. You know, is this the modern family in the top kind of left-hand side? You know, kids have access to up to 7 or 8 devices in a house. No longer are we satisfied with just living the event. We have to record the event to relive the event. And this was me on the tube this morning. Is this a start of dystopia? No, why is it? Replace every single one of those. This is them 20 minutes later. Yeah, ironically, the little old lady's still on her phone. This is what I love about this picture. Everyone else has got their book out, their Kindle out, the newspaper, the Metro. The little old lady, she's just on there. But this is brilliant. This is just a window to connect and socialize. Because that's what we're designed to do, is to be social. So it's not bad, but you're competing, yeah? You go back to there. Each of them is trying to consume content. And you look at the behavior, and you've all done this about, you get on the train, sometimes we're so addicted to it, we just have to keep turning it on and off to see, have I got another email? Or, you know, has something changed? Something's miraculously changed in the last 15 seconds. I'm opening up the same email, nothing, you know? Nothing's come on Facebook. Oh. Nothing's come on the news anymore. We're in and out, but we've got to learn to shut off and do this. Because the thing with social media and the thing with people is that we like to be liked. You know, big reason for schools and education not going into social media is because it's bad. Yeah, it's all about cyberbullying. Yeah, and about predators. And honestly, yeah, community. I've never gone into one school where I've gone, yeah, I really endorse the fact that that person's been slagging us off. No. you're part of a community and you're round it. Yeah, I want positive stories, and you've got to flood your communities with positive stories. You connect with them, and so your message has got to be optimistic. It's got to be positive, and it's got to be authentic. Yeah, with social media marketing, it's not about forcing. Yeah, you cannot just say you're the best at this, the best at that, because people go, yeah, whatever. Let me make the decision. TripAdvisor, Amazon. How many of you bought things off Amazon without actually looking at the reviews? I bet none of you have bought a one-star product. If you have, you're mad. Yeah. We go because we trust it. Yeah. We trust what people say. And so the old way of marketing was very one way, isn't it? You know, when I had an agency, this is what we did. We could buy people. Yeah. We had literally five channels: TV, press, radio, magazines. Yeah. It was easy. Yeah, spend enough money, I could buy you. The problem with the social is it's become two-way. And actually, brands hold no value. You hold no value. So we've got to be clever then about how we build a community. And we've got to try and build communities, because communities are the ones that are going to start to share your message. So you can't be overtly kind of pushy. So I'm going to give you some examples about social strategies for your business, because it's really important that you get it right. The first thing you need to do is understand your handle. And your handle is more important than your URL. Will people find you at facebook.com/mybusiness? And then literally get rid of the URL and put in Instagram, put in Twitter, my business. You have to own your handle. Yeah? Even if you're not on Snapchat, even if you're not on LinkedIn, you have to own your handle. You also have to think about your own hashtag strategies. And for my business, Interactive Schools, you know, these are the ones that we don't own them. You don't own a hashtag, but we make it part of our own DNA. Other people can jump on it, but they actually add no value to it. What we've got to do is go, do you know, we're about this. We're about inspiring schools. We're about school websites, parent comms. Yeah? This is what we want to do. We repeat it and repeat it and repeat it on everything that we do. So the community gets to be able to kind of share and do it. So think about it. Think about what hashtags you may use. And they may be branded hashtags. Yeah, I've seen a lot of hashtags around these displays and they're just meaningless. You know, hashtag dream. I mean, hashtag who cares? I mean, it really, there's no relevance to what I'm doing. So honestly, think about it. If you want engagement, you've got to have that thread. You know, start to think about your profiles. You know, we're a marketing agency selling high-end websites and communication strategies to schools around the world. But actually, we're a global community. It's very different. You know, we've got nearly 11,000 followers. That's not done because we're trying to sell a product. It's done because we care about the community and the market that we're in. Yeah. You've got to start to think about writing your own content. Get into blogging. Now, how many of you write a blog? Any of you? Is that a business blog or a personal blog? Business? Yeah. And again, with all these things, you've got to think about the content that you're putting out there. Is it relevant? You know, this one here. You know, this is interesting because we sell into education. That doesn't help me sell a website. Not one bit. But actually, it's interesting because we find it interesting as part of our market and our model. You then got to look at your communication strategy. And then do you then start to send out emails? Emails are a really good push, yeah? But the content's got to be exciting and relevant. You've got to target and talk about the blog that you've just done. It's no good putting a blog and going, oh, I hope you find us. You then start to think about your comms strategy, and it's actually, where do you publish it? Do I email it? Do I put it on my website? Do I tweet about it? You know, what about, is it on LinkedIn? Have I reused it there? How else do I do it as I go down? And there's lots of ways you can start to do it. You know, this is just a newsletter that we send out weekly to our customers. And we're sharing lots of interesting information, case studies, but a lot of it's content that's relevant to them, not actually us selling it. But in between, by the way, we do this. Look at this great case study. And we'll get a hook. So you've got to start to think, I've got to balance what I do. You know, this is one of our most popular tweets. It's not selling websites or social media, is it? But huge engagement. Our biggest tweet to date reached over 1 million people. It's not selling websites or social media or content strategies. It's engaging with a community that go, that's interesting. And that is interesting. You know? Why aren't all schools like that? I kind of walk around the school now and going, God, you should have everything drawn up on the walls, you know, portals going in, make them fun. If you're going to do your own content as well, you can start to promote different things. So we run something called Social Advent every year. So we get schools involved and we help draft out a strategy. It's an easy win because actually Advent people are familiar with. 25 days, 25 actions here. You can start your content strategy. So we're giving them something back to give them the skills to be better at what they need to do. We did a periodic table of social apps because that's the market we're in. So we thought that would be relevant and actually contextual. But in between that, we do need to promote what you do. Not every single tweet, not every single post, not everything you put out there, but you still need to go, oh, by the way, this is what we do. We're not just here giving you free content, we sell. This is what we do, and look how brilliant it is, yeah? So someone might then have the hook, they might be interested. Marketing, this is at Bett, marketing, Bett hashtags, yeah? Trade shows are really important, but you've got to choose the right ones that are going to work for you as an organization, because they don't all work, by the way, yeah? We tried this last year, it doesn't work, yeah? It didn't work for us, but it works for other platforms. You don't have to just to be there, but then use it, you know? I was in America just before Christmas at a trade show, but you still can use digital to share the fact that you're at a trade show. Be part of the conference hashtag. Get in the conversation. If you're not in the conversation, you have no chance of getting impact or reach. It may go nowhere, but if you do nothing, you're going to stand no chance, yeah? So give it a go. Try and do stuff. Come up with ideas, capture your story as you go. And with Cobus, I know that Jamie was here earlier talking with Cobus, and again at their conference, we kind of put together a table, something that all the delegates might be interested in. So think about the content that you've got. Could you put something into something that you attended that might be of value to them that also gives you an edge? You know, for us, it's around Twitter because we do a huge amount of social strategies around the world. So for us, it was relevance, bringing stuff that we do but giving something back to the schools to go, this is how you're doing. Yeah. So again, you can be clever about what you do as you go through it. Likewise, you know, this is not selling websites. Not at all. And it's deliberately not meant to be.
Hi, I'm Omar, and welcome to King's Academy. You already know about our stellar academic program. You've heard all about our diverse student body and our world-class faculty. But how about I tell you some things you may not know about King's Academy?
So, does your school make its own olive oil? Well, mine does. Do we have a fencing program? Of course we do. How about a feline rescue house? Yes, we have kittens. Does your school have the biggest library in the region? No, it doesn't.
Shh. Mine does.
And someone asked me if we have a space program. What kind of question is that? Does your school have professors from Hogwarts? Mine does.
Here at King's Academy, we even teach philosophy.
Plato!
That wasn't philosophy, was it?
What does your school collect? Mine collects flags.
우리의 국기를 보여줄까요?
아니야, 지기야. You already knew that our school gives more financial aid than any other school in the region. You didn't? Well, now you do. And we even have a graduation every year. Do you have football fields, squash, tennis, and basketball courts, a gym, a semi-Olympic swimming pool, a physiotherapist, and a lion in your backyard? Well, come to King's and you will. King's is my school. But it could be yours too. I'm on a horse. Come on, man. You're embarrassing me.
Utterly genius. Yeah? Have you seen a better school video? I haven't. Yeah? That's the enrollment officer of the school. I thought it was an actor. But it's the guy. But and they've done a whole series of it, and it's brilliant. And to get that type of buy-in at your school, difficult, yeah? I know the fact, because schools don't like change. They want talking heads. That took a lot of balls, and they pushed it through, and they delivered something that's authentic, fun, different. I like the personality of that school. I want to send my kids there, yeah? So it's not about the big marketing message, nothing. It's about being different and authentic, you know? You've got to stand out, hence the slide. Make it stand out. Thank you very much. I believe my time's up, so it's going to be question time. So hope you found that useful, fun, interesting, social.